Picture this. It's a lazy Saturday morning, and you're rolling out of bed around 11 a.m. You look around realizing that your room is a mess. You get up and start to organize the room, and then suddenly it's 2 p.m., and your stomach feels like a hollow drum, and it's making it hard to clean. You recall that the last time you ate anything was a little popcorn at the movie last night. Hunger is setting in as you have a physical need for food. Going so long without food is causing discomfort and a desire to eat, driven by the hypothalamus in your brain, nerves in your gastrointestinal tract, and hormone changes signaling that the body wants food, and now. You venture to the kitchen and eat a large bowl of cereal containing 3 or more servings of cereal and milk. You're full and satisfied. In scientific terms, you're satiated. You go back to cleaning and organizing, only to find half of your favorite candy bar in a desk drawer. As you hear the crinkle of the wrapper and see the chocolate-covered nuts and caramel, you get a small whiff of the sweet deliciousness. Although both hunger and appetite are different by definition, they both drive you to eat, and the process that the food goes through once consumed is the same. Although you're satiated, your appetite was just stimulated. Appetite is psychological in nature and driven by your senses. It's a pleasant sensation as you decide if you're going to take a bite. The digestive system has many parts that work together to turn the food on your plate into the fabric of your body. Yes, you are what you eat, so long as what you eat can be digested and absorbed. Let's map out the digestive system, starting with a question. Have you ever thought about what happens to food as it passes through your body? Food drastically changes as it goes through the digestive tract. The main jobs of the digestive tract are to digest food and then absorb the breakdown products of that food. Through digestion, we can alter the food mechanically through chewing, churning, mixing, segmentation, and peristalsis. And we can alter the food chemically using digestive enzymes. Digestive enzymes break bonds in the food and allow for the food to break down to a form that is easily absorbed. But what happens in each part along the tract? Starting at the beginning, food enters your mouth. You chew it, and it mixes with the saliva containing the enzyme salivary amylase. While chewing, the food is mechanically broken down. At the same time, salivary amylase breaks bonds in starch, a complex carbohydrate. Once the food is chewed and rolled by your tongue into a moist ball, or bolus, we swallow it. So, although we have 6 nutrients, only starch is chemically digested in the mouth. Next, the bolus travels down a long, hollow tube we call the esophagus. The end of the esophagus empties into the stomach, where the bolus is churned and mixed with stomach juices, becoming a liquid mash called chyme. Just like the mouth, only one main nutrient is chemically digested in the stomach. The stomach produces proteases, which are enzymes that chemically digest proteins. Once the chyme spends enough time in the stomach digesting protein and decreasing particle size, it leaves the stomach and enters the small intestine, the site for most digestion and absorption. The small intestine is where it's at. With the help of accessory organs, all macronutrients are digested to their building blocks, or monomers, in the small intestine. Those monomers can then be absorbed from the small intestine into your blood and body. Any undigested digesta passes to the large intestine where water and select micronutrients are absorbed. Phew! That is a long way for food to travel. In fact, the route along the digestive tract from your mouth to anus is about 30 feet long, or 10 yards. The remaining material passes out of the body as feces. But that's not the whole story. Sometimes the digestive tract runs into problems. Understanding the digestive tract, its functions, and possible problems can be overwhelming. Let's break down some difficult terms so we can better understand them. GERD stands for gastroesophageal reflux disease. Gastro is a prefix referring to the stomach. Esophageal relates to the esophagus. Reflux is the act of something coming back up. And disease can be thought of as dis-ease, or an uncomfortable or harmful deviation from normal function. People also refer to GERD as heartburn. For the next term, let's look at a little case study. Sean wakes up and makes herself a bowl of cereal, like she does almost every morning before work. Later that morning at work, she starts feeling a lot of pain in her stomach and it looks bloated. Eventually, it gets so bad that she spends the next 20 minutes in the bathroom. After her pain subsides, Sean wonders if it was caused by her breakfast, since she hadn't eaten anything else that day. She sets up an appointment with her doctor and finds out that she's lactose intolerant. Her doctor explains that lactose is milk sugar, and intolerance means that the body can't digest it. This is due to a lack of the enzyme lactase, which breaks down those milk sugars. her doctor says to get Lactate, an over-the-counter pill containing lactase to help her digest lactose and dairy. As you understand the digestive tract and how it functions, it becomes increasingly evident that a balanced diet and a healthy lifestyle can help prevent uncomfortable and sometimes debilitating disorders.